spending, our society is spending so much money, and what is it getting in return? So let me start with an example, which some of you have already heard this example, that if a 60-year-old patient came with sudden onset headache, he is non-hypertensive, he has vomiting, left hemiplegia, and altered consciousness, which started 3 years ago. Not difficult for physicians to make a diagnosis. This is very likely intracerebral hemorrhage. And unfortunately, there is no very, let's say, specific treatment which is available for intracerebral hemorrhage. So this is the CT scan of the individual, and this increased on second day or third day of the onset of stroke. And as you can see, that it has almost doubled as far as volume is concerned. And then in New England Journal of Medicine in 2005, this paper came. And our residents, as you know, they read only the conclusion of the abstract. They don't have time to read even the whole abstract. So they just read conclusions. And many physicians do that for good reasons, sometimes paucity of time, and also to check whether there is anything interesting in the paper. But conclusion said, treatment with recombinant factor 7A within 4 hours after onset of intracerebral hemorrhage limits the growth of hematoma, reduces mortality, and improves functional outcome at 90 days, despite a small increase in the frequency of thromboembolic adverse events. It was so convincing, and of course published in the top medical practice journal, New England Journal of Medicine, with a multicentric trial done in USA. Many of our colleagues, we are convinced to use it. And the drug company brought this first author, Stephen Myers, to India and took him to all the major cities and organized meeting of the practitioners, particularly neurologists, to listen to him. And he was trying to convince everyone based on this study that they should use this medicine as a tool or as a treatment to reduce the growth of hematoma, and of course reduce mortality, improves functional outcome. So all good results as far as your expectation from a treatment is concerned. So many of my colleagues, they started using it. But as an informed practitioner, if you read this paper carefully, then there are many problems, and even Stephen Myers was aware about it. And he was not describing this in US, but conducting another trial. Some people were aware, some people not aware. And seeing that it is not right to use it, but people are using it, I had to convince our editor to allow me to publish the critical appraisal of this paper. And he agreed to publish this in 2007, as you can see. 2005 was the paper, and took me some time to convince people, and the, of course, change also the title. And I wrote, it is premature to use recombinant activated coagulation factor 7A in intracerebral hemorrhage, published in Annals of Indian Academy of Neurology. Indian practitioners were using it, so it was all the more important to publish in Indian journals so that people can see and read and become aware of limitations of the study. And people perhaps didn't pay so much attention to it, because the previous paper, as I said, was published in very high impact factor journal, and they were convinced by the lectures given by Stephen Myers. But I also made one argument that at least you wait for an ongoing trial which is coming to an end. In 2007, I wrote this paper. 2008, same authors published another paper in same New England Journal of Medicine, which was a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial in 122 centers with 841 patients with intracerebral hemorrhage. placebo group, 20 microgram group, 80 microgram. What did they find? Growth in volume of hematoma reduces by 2.6 ml, half teaspoon with 20 microgram and little more with 80 microgram. But what is important is, what is the proportion with poor clinical outcome? In placebo group, 24%. In 20 microgram group, 26%. In 80 microgram group, 29%. So more medicine you give, worse is the frequency of poor clinical outcome. And still worse was that many patients were dying of myocardial infarction. We, in our experience, we know most patients who die in intracerebral hemorrhage, they die of herniation, brain herniation, and therefore compromise of respiration and brain death. But here people were dying of in myocardial infarction much more frequently in 80 microgram, as you can imagine, compared to placebo, which was statistically significant, and there was no improvement in survival of functional outcome. This medicine was never approved by FDA of USA or any other regulatory agency, and of course after this paper came, then people stopped using it. But if they had known some aspects of good research and how to critically appraise research, they would not have made this mistake. So even if you are told, you should be aware of some of the basic tenets of research methodology so that you can at least read papers very critically and only apply if you are convinced that it is ready to be applied in clinical practice. So in this age, now patients also bring a lot of information. They will bring some printouts from internet and will ask you to tell them about taking one treatment or the other. So even every day, even from your family members, as I get from my family members, if somebody has a problem, they read it in internet and get something which they like, because something where surgery is avoided, for example, or some treatment has been reported as very good, they will ask you whether they should use it. Now, when patients come to me, I usually tell them that, look here, you give me some time. Let me read about this. And unless I have already read about it, and then I will get back to you and you will get papers which you will critically appraise and then tell them what is the right thing to do. Now, another reason why we should know a little bit, at least a little bit of research method, is there is so much information explosion in biomedical sciences that you have to sift the clinically relevant and scientifically sound papers from those which are basically only to give support to further research rather than come to practice. And another thing which I am going to show to you, that there is whatever even is established is not really being translated into practice. It's partly because it is a system failure, and partly because we are not aware of what is the current level of evidence. So for example, more than 20,000 journals, more than 2 million articles. I told you that we need, when we read, we need to separate insignificant and unsound from salient and crucial, and that is why critical appraisal of articles are very important. All the papers which are published need not be applied into clinical practice, because some are only to justify further research. Some are published only to, you can say, raise questions, which we call hypothesis generation, but they are not meant for application into clinical practice. So distinguish between what is relevant for practice and what is immature or premature. You should be able to do some clinical research, and if not, at least you should be aware of what are the characteristics of good clinical research. And this is not only what I am saying. If you have heard of yearbook selects only 5% of about a million articles based on quality and clinical relevance. And then every year they publish, that's why it is called yearbook. In a BMJ editorial in 1991, said only 1% of published articles are scientifically valid. I hope this situation is slightly better now, but it gives you an idea that why you need to know some of the basic tenets of science and research to be able to become a good practitioner. Similarly, ACP Journal Club, which is American College of Physicians Journal Club, they when they take 5 best journals and take 2 issues, that yields just 1 article, which is scientifically valid and clinically relevant. So you can imagine 2 issues out of 5 best journals, and those 5 best journals are the England Journal of Medicine, Lancet, Annals of Internal Medicine, Journal of American Medical Association, and British Medical Journal. If you take these 5 best journals, best in the sense that they have the highest impact factor, take 2 issues of all of them, you will get only 1 article which is scientifically valid and clinically relevant. Now, how do you pick up that one good article which is clinically relevant and scientifically valid? You need to be aware of some of the issues of research methodology. The second reason you need to be aware is there are umpteen examples where proven interventions are underused or underdosed. Now, simple example like aspirin, which is, there is no reason why every ischemic stroke patient should not get it, at least when there is no contraindication. But still, you will be surprised that many people are deprived of it, sometimes because we don't talk to them, the need for it, and sometimes because patients by themselves, they stop it, or sometimes we are not very convincing about what we are prescribing. On the other hand, we are prescribing therapies without proven benefit. I know in stroke field, we wrote a paper where paracetam, edaravone, citicoline, so much prescribed in India, and certainly none of the countries where regulation is tight, and any guideline which you read, any guideline from Western countries, whether European or American or Japanese, they will not write any one of these to be used. But we find that this is being used in hundreds, thousands of patients, millions of patients in India. I call it, this is a paradox, that proven interventions not used. And we did a study, one of my residents did a study, 50% of patients with ischemic stroke were not getting aspirin, and 50% were getting at least one of these. So that is what is I call PPP. In this case, it stands for pathetic prescription paradox. So what is proven and is inexpensive, is established effective, is not used. What is not proven, that is used in plenty, that is the paradox which I call pathetic prescription paradox. And this is not only in India, to some extent it is there in every country. And I'll give you some example. One of my residents did a retrospective as well as prospective audit of what is in the case records of patients. So, of course, brain imaging everybody is getting. Aspirin, prospectively, if we take, 94% is getting, 98% in retrospective. But look at the physiotherapy, 87% were getting it. Perhaps we were not recording, 17% were getting in retrospective, because there is perhaps a problem in recording. Statins, which almost 100% people should get it unless there is contraindication, but it's still not prescribed as frequently as we would like. Similarly, carotid Doppler, which should be perhaps in practically every case unless it is a disabling stroke, is used only in 50%. Now, you may think that it is only Indian scenario, but look at Royal College of Physicians stroke audit in UK, and you can see that brain scan within 24 hours was in 58%, which became 100%. But physiotherapist assessment was still lagging behind, and therapies, language therapy assessment was also lagging behind very grossly. Nutritional assessment also lagging behind grossly. And if you go to screening for swallowing, there was 60%, 64% in National Stroke Audit of UK. And formal sensory testing or formal assessment of visual fields only in 63%. So there are gaps in every country. In US, there is a study which is published. More than 9.5% HbA1c in 18% patients, hypertension uncontrolled in 34% patients, LDL uncontrolled in 58% patients, self-monitoring of glucose only in 38%, dilated eye exam, which should be done every year in diabetic patients, only 63% got it. This is published in 2002. Situation may be much better now. Foot examination in 55%. So a lot of proven things which we are expected to do, we don't do. And same thing is true for Canada, for Europe. 36 to 60% receive angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, beta blockers for heart failure. And similarly, there is under prescription of warfarin in atrial fibrillation. There is therefore a need to translate whatever we know to fill up these gaps. So how do we translate? First, we should be aware of what is proven and what is not proven. We should agree to what is published and what you become aware. Maybe you have reasons not to agree to that sometimes, which is perfectly fine. If you have reasons which are solid and you don't agree, like I told you example of recombinant factor 7a, I didn't agree, so I didn't use it. But if I become aware and then I agree, then I should adopt that treatment. And for that, we need to be very careful and very persistent. So one of the areas where your students, residents, and practitioners all can work is knowledge translation. And this I'm telling you after listening and discussing over years by many private practitioners. Some of them towards the fag end, they will come and say that, can you involve me in research? I am so much fed up every day doing the same thing, same surgery, same patients. I want to do something different, so I want to get involved in research. These are people who work in private. They have worked throughout their life in private practice, but they want to get involved in research. Even just 1 month ago, some people from gastroenterology, they wanted to develop guidelines. So guidelines, whether you are in private practice or in government or you are researcher, you will be involved in guideline development at least some stage in your life. And that will be much better informed you if you have some fundamentals clear about research methodology. Of course, if you want to translate knowledge, you have to educate people, give feedback, give some incentives. Like in some countries, they are giving incentives to hospitals where there is 100% adherence to proven interventions. Sometimes you have to do administrative regulation. Like you have to say that, look here, if you are going to miss certain things, then you will be punished. If you are going to over prescribe or prescribe something which is unnecessary, then you also you will be punished. So those are sanctions. And for all of this, you need what we may call health services research, practice-based research. Now this is not not to be undervalued, because as I said, unless we know what is going on in practice, we will not know the gaps, and we will not be able to bridge that gap or translate what is known into practice. So practice-based research is something which all of us can do. Even students can do, even residents can do, practitioners can do, with little bit of planning and of course some insight into what is important. So I will give you some example of guidelines, because at some stage of your life you will be either involved in developing guidelines or you will be using guidelines, and perhaps all of us are already using guidelines. You may be in some association, some organization which is developing guidelines. Sometimes you may be involved in making national level guidelines. Sometimes you may be involved in some international effort at guidelines. So one example, in our stroke association in Indian Academy of Neurology, in 2010, we developed national guidelines. I was having the privilege to chair this group. But I should tell you that when I told them that we will use international standards, what WHO is using, and then I sent some papers to them about how they develop guidelines, practically all of my colleagues said that, look here, this is a new thing for us, we don't know, we don't understand. Some of them said this is Greek and Latin, so can we do it the usual way this time? Next time we will do better. So we write it in this guideline that we are not using the globally accepted standards for developing the guideline, but we are using little, you can say, substandard method, but we will update next time and use the standard methods. Then we, in 2019, it was a national effort, Government of India asked us to develop this national guideline for stroke management and prevention. And again, I had the privilege to be convener of this. And we worked hard, but again faced the same problem, because people were not aware of research methodology. They didn't want to use grading the evidence and strength of recommendation just the way WHO does or other organizations do. So I felt that if there was some training, some kind of exposure of these people in medical college, when they are students, when they are residents, probably this thing will not arise. And still we are lagging behind what are the international standards for developing guidelines. But on the other hand, as one of our resident, Telangana, who is actually born in Telangana, so she wrote a she first presented a seminar. After the seminar, I told her that you better write a paper on this because you have done a good job. She worked hard and published this paper, which says that an ectoplase is as good as alteplase in acute ischemic stroke. This was, and the cost of this is about, you can say, 1/3 of the cost of alteplase. So when we published this, we expected that people will used in ectoplase, because it was licensed for use in ischemic stroke. It was not licensed for use in other countries. But because it was not licensed, there was no guideline. So we developed our own guideline. Then asked, up to date, can you change your recommendation? Because our meta-analysis shows that it should be encouraged and it should be used. As you can see, up to date, which is a very popular textbook, electronic textbook amongst residents and even faculty, perhaps all parts of the world, certainly in US and UK, they wrote that ectoplase is investigational therapy. And this was one reason which why our residents, even though Government of India or Drug Controller General of India had approved this, they were not using it. When our meta-analysis was published, we wrote to UpToDate. And we wrote that UpToDate is widely used, of course, all over the world and also in India. Tenecteplase is approved in India, while in other countries, it is approved only for MI, but it is approved for ischemic stroke also in India. But the why is your UpToDate not including this as one of the effective treatments? So I said, if you agree to consider this, I will send you our meta-analysis and grade program. So after some time, and you can see after about 2 months, they changed it. And I thank them that they changed it. And they changed it, but they don't use it. So they wrote wrong doses, which I had. What they wrote is, although not licensed in the US for thrombolysis in acute ischemic stroke treatment, there is moderate to high quality evidence that intravenous tenecteplase, the dose is wrong. This, because they didn't use it, they don't know. But I had to make the correction after that. I noticed this has similar efficacy and safety outcomes compared to eltepley, including rates of excellent functional outcomes, symptomatic intracerebral hemorrhage, and mortality at 90 days. They gave references, and one of the references was our meta-analysis. This is in July 2019. So when I republished this, I was invited in one of the US hospitals to give a grand round, and I can tell you that all the attendees, they wanted to use it, but there was no license from US FDA. That's why they were not using it. They were actually annoyed with US FDA about this, which continues even till date. So US FDA has approved eltepley for myocardial infarction as well as ischemic stroke in a gap of about, as you can see, 9 years. But tenecteplase has been approved for MI in 2000. Even after 21 years, it has not been approved for ischemic stroke. So there are many reasons for this, some of which Americans told me is basically commercial interest or company interest or whatever. But we are lucky that in India, it is approved. So if we didn't know the methodology, how to make guideline, we would not have been able to put it in our guideline, which we were able to do in our national guideline. International experience, if you know the methodology, you will not be surprised if you get international people asking you to chair a group, and you also get international people in your fold to develop a guideline. So a rapid clinical practice guideline was developed under my chairmanship, where, as you can see, even Gordon Guyatt, who is I think a doyen in research methodology as well as guideline development, was also a member, and I had the privilege to chair it, and we published it in BMJ. So that was about dual antiplatelet therapy. If I didn't have exposure to this, then neither the research international group will work with me, or nor they will really accept that I chair a group which is consisting mostly of very well-established methodologies. So if you really know this, even if you don't do research, at least you will be able to develop good guidelines at your association level, your institute level, your country level, or even international. That is the point I'm trying to make. And how will it help? It helps to translate what is already known in clinical practice. So as you can see, original research, 18% are negative, they never get published. If they are submitted, negative results, 46% are rejected. If it is accepted then and published, then a lot of it does not go into bibliographic databases because they may be published in different language. Finally, if some gets into it, then reviews, guidelines, textbooks are published, but it takes about 6 to 13 years before it is really getting into guidelines. Then even after guidelines, sometimes it takes 9 years to get to see it in implementation. So you can see that on an average, it takes 17 years to turn 14% of original research to the benefit of patient care. So that is something which we should keep in mind. Don't know why this is not moving. think I'll have to redo this because it has got blocked now.
Sir, click on the slide first and then.
No, it's moving now. It's moving now. So I'll give you another example. This is about streptokinase in myocardial infarction. So somebody did a very good job that right from first randomized control trials, this was first in before 1960, it collected, looked at all the trials which were done. 70 trials were done up to 1990. And what it did was, it looked at the number of patients in the trial and then depicted the results of the trial with a line, which is actually line of confidence interval, in a graph where there is a vertical line, which is line of no effect. So if there is a line of no difference, if something is on the left of the line, then it favors treatment entirely on the left. If it is entirely on the right, then it is against the treatment. If it is crossing this line, means we don't know whether it is helpful or harmful. So first study was so small that the line was crossing all over, which means we didn't know, because of a small study, whether it is helpful or it is harmful. The second study came, the author has combined first and second study. So with 65 patients, which means a total of 88 patients, the line was slightly more towards the left, but still crossing the line, so we don't know whether it is. With 95% confidence, we don't know whether it is helpful or it is harmful. It went, then he got third study and he went on combining, So this is combination of four study. Still we don't know. Fifth study, still we don't know whether it is helpful or harmful, but perhaps more likely to be helpful. But from 10th study onwards, which is a summary of all the 10 studies so far, it is entirely towards the left, which means it favors the use of streptokinase in myocardial infarction. Still more and more studies were done. It remained towards the left, confidence interval became narrow. But what is surprising is that with 6,000 subjects, even though in mid 70s, it was clear that it is helpful, in after mid 80s, they did a study which was of 15,000 subjects, I think ISIS 2 study, which again, of course, showed the same thing. But even after that, so remember 50% did not get streptokinase in this. Even after that, there was a GC study in, organized by Italians with 25,000 subjects, which was also, of course, when you combine it, shows the same thing. And you wonder why they were doing so many studies when there was clearly benefit shown with previous studies. And the reason they were doing studies on the right hand side, what the authors did was, they looked at textbooks and review articles, because this is where guidelines were not very popular at that time. So only textbook and review articles were the source of, you know, implementation of treatment. And they classified their recommendations into routinely use, recommendation for routine use, recommendation to use in specific group of patients. It should rarely be used. It is an experimental drug or not mentioned at all. So when you look at this point where p-value is less than 0.01 with 22 studies, for example, there were 7 textbook articles or review recommendations. They did not mention it at all. Similarly, in 1982 or so, 13 articles, 12 did not mention, and one said it should be used in specific group of patients. Some meta-analysis, M stands for meta-analysis, when meta-analysis got published, then people started, of course, writing more in favor of use of routine, use of streptokinase. And when by the time this large number of patients were studied, practically everyone started saying that it should be used routinely, and it came into practice. But it takes so many years. Even if we look at mid 70s, from 75, it was almost 10, 15 years by the time it really came into routine practice. So you will say, why did it happen? And was it ethical to do studies when this was the evidence? The reason is nobody was doing a meta-analysis. And therefore, because people don't know the limits of the studies, limitations of the studies, they really did not understand whether they should use it or not. Even authors did not know what to write. And only after people start having did large trials that people got convinced, and also meta-analysis came into support this treatment. But only after this Cochrane collaboration has come, and now the same thing is being done routinely, and hopefully this story will not be repeated. And this is another example to show that when it comes to research, there are different priorities for research funding. Sometimes developing country priorities are not given so much research funding. But suppose you have research funding, then you apply for grants, you get peer reviewed and you get some grants. Then you do a research and publish it, it is peer reviewed. Then somebody will do research synthesis or meta-analysis, which will further strengthen the use of some treatment, which is evidence-based. Then it will go into guidelines and finally into practice. It takes 17 years before some of the things which are really subjected to research get into practice. So one of the thing is that if you want to read critical appraisal, I know I have written a book which is available free. So I have no hesitation in telling you that I hope the publisher is not listening to me, that there is a PDF which is available free to download. And that tells you about critical appraisal and meta-analysis in a very introductory fashion. Now, the question about gap between research and practice is not new. It was seen even in case of scurvy, 1953. Sir Richard Hawkins recommended that what he has seen is most people who are given oranges, they are oranges and lemons, they are not sick with scurvy. 61, as you know, Lancaster shows that lemon juice supplement eliminates scurvy among sailors. It was not a randomized trial. But 1747, James Lynn shows that citrus juice supplement eliminates scurvy. This was a controlled study, not randomized controlled trial in typical sense, but it was a controlled study. But 1795, British Navy implemented citrus juice supplements. So you can imagine from 1593, it was taking 200 years before it was implemented routinely. So it was much worse earlier. Now we are better, but we should get better and better. So translating research into practice, as I say that there, some people call it TG1 and TG2, translational gap 1, translational gap 2. TG1 is when it is research and going to bedside means patients, it takes time. So bench to bedside, bedside means clinical trials, so it will take some time. After clinical trials are done, then also it will take some time before it gets into practice, which is called TG2. And NIH was also being criticized because over years, they have spent $250 billion. And we are not saying, this is the statement from made by sector, we are not seeing the breakthrough therapy as people expect. Over past 30 years, basic science and clinical disconnect is increasing. And this is what was published in Nature in 2008 as crossing the valley of death. So on one hand, there are basic researchers where you can see test tubes and flasks and things like this. On the other hand, there are treating clinicians. And in between, there is such a big gap where a lot of innovations and inventions which are made in basic science, they actually meet death rather than crossing this and getting into practice. The reason is that biomedical researchers and clinicians, they are not connected as much as it should be. One example will be cell-based therapies, where there may be some basic lab work which is done in maybe in small animals, which gives proof of concept, but it takes several years of development, phase one, phase two, phase three trial, and so on, till it comes for in routine clinical practice, which will be, of course, years and years. And I have told you one example of 17 years there. So we, what I want to say is that clinicians should do a lot of research to bridge that gap, which you may call translational research. So from basic science to human study, that is one kind of research. And once clinical studies have established the efficacy, then another kind of research, which will be to bring it into routine practice. A lot of, as I said, showed you that audit of practice can also be a kind of research, which I think all students, residents, practitioners can do. And it should be done to highlight the gap so that there is early translation. So we know so much about malnutrition and treatment of malnutrition, but it is so rampant in Jharkhand, still because what we know is not translated perfectly. So we at least we should highlight those gaps by doing research, and also do research on how to translate this knowledge. So you may use different kind of operations and operational research to make sure that whatever is known, it goes into practice to improve the health of the people. And this is not myself saying this, director of NIH in 2005 wrote, that is the responsibility of those of us involved in today's biomedical research enterprise to translate the remarkable scientific innovations we are witnessing into health gains for the nation. This is what they call as T1, T2, T3 kind of translational research. From basic science, you may start doing phase one, phase two clinical trials, which will be T1 research. Then from phase three clinical trials to practice, T2 kind of research, which may be practice-based, and guidelines, meta-analysis, systematic reviews, and then dissemination research, which will be T3 kind of research. So translational research can be at various levels. And even if you can't do basic research because you don't have labs, you may not be able to do phase one, phase two. You can do dissemination research, you can do guideline development, you can do meta-analysis, you can do systematic reviews. All of these are possible by any researcher anywhere. And this has been highlighted, the need for this has been highlighted by just showing that over the years, number of research grants for MD, PhD people is declined, is from 1970. It has been increasing, but still, as you can see, there are so many gaps which are visible. Now, why it is happening? Because we are not having a clinician investigator or clinician scientist. Basic scientists don't want to come out of their comfort zone, and we don't have clinical scientists, and therefore clinical research gets neglected. So as we have a lot of public health challenges now coming, of course, chronic conditions, aging population, health disparities, but not to forget COVID-19 like emerging diseases, and of course, bioterrorism, biodefense, and so on. All of this needs some research. Biology has become very complex, but that doesn't mean we can't do research on patients or on populations. Those are the things which we should work on. For this, you have to establish certain structure which will involve not only epidemiologists, biostatisticians, but data management people, genomics, bioinformatics, proteomics, other omics kind of experts. And then you should have clinical sites. Even if we have all of this, but clinical sites are not active, it will not get translated and we will not get final proof. In India, of course, now I'm hearing IITs are developing their own medical colleges. In India, 75% of R&D budget comes from public fund. Private, particularly pharma, are not really spending much time on research. Only 3% of health budget for Ayurveda is spent by Ayush, which is means practically very little research in this area, which I wish should increase, and we should do much more research on Ayurveda. And as you know, less than 1% of GDP is being spent on research and development in India. So I would say that there are problems. Clinicians are very busy, they don't have resources, they don't have time, and therefore it is very difficult to encourage people to do clinical research. But as I have shown that a lot of research can be done without strong labs, a lot of research can be done on practice, a lot of research can be done on translating what is already known. And therefore, in medical education, we should bring research to the MBBS, undergraduates. And it is not only my saying this. American Association of Medical Colleges said from their first day of medical school, students should begin hearing about clinical research. That will actually engender interrogative intellectual approach, curiosity, and reflection amongst the students. So before I conclude, the idea is that we have to motivate students to become physician scientists. They are becoming physicians, but scientific approach, scientific temper, scientific methodology should be at least known to them so that they can participate in translational research. They should experience by doing some research. And of course, PG students are all supposed to do their thesis. They should do it properly. There should be some foundation for research. And I'm happy to see that ICMR has started student stipend for some research summer grant. But we should have more opportunities for students, for residents to learn proper method of doing research. And that will be a basis for evidence-based practice. And I can tell you that once you start doing this, then you enjoy it much, much more. And then you get addicted to it that you are not able to really stop it. So I hope some of you will reach that stage. It will give you prestige and self-esteem, and it will, of course, further the career of students, residents, but in your own career in promotion. But more importantly, it will contribute to society and humanity. And as I have shown, that even a work of small resident can change the textbook, which is used widely across the globe. So it is not only that you should be receiving information, you should be also contributing to information so that the rest of the world also follows this. And certainly in our own country, we can follow things which are useful, which are less expensive, like I gave you example of connectivity. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I would ask Ravi to allow you to ask questions. Stop sharing. Okay. Yes, any question?
Hello, good morning. I'm Apoorv Parekh from Indore.
Oh, Apoorv, welcome, welcome.
Good. I enjoyed listening to you as always. And you have taken a good initiative from RIMS to start this series of Saturday lectures. And I think the way you explained the gaps, the translational gaps, 1, 2, 3, and all those things, and the delay involved, and the message is very pertinent. There are, of course, many practical problems and issues, and I think we all will have to work together. Number one, to percolate this message far and wide, in which I will contribute in my own manner at every level. Number two, we should encourage institutions, even private practitioners, to use more of electronic health record. That will help in generation of data. And particularly have seen
I can't hear you, Puranik.
Apurva sir, your bandwidth is low, so you can close the video and just continue with the audio, sir.
Just continue with the audio. Close the video so that you are audible. Apurva, you can close the video because we can't hear you. Ah, yes, yes. Now perhaps we can do that. Unfortunately, we can't hear, but those of you who don't know, Dr. Apurva Pouranik and myself, we were batchmates in DM Neurology. And we have continued to be good friends. And to propagate research, I should tell you that he has established, from his own contribution, has established Research Excellence Award in Indore. And I'm happy to see that very good papers and large number of people are really participating and getting encouraged to do this. So he has done it in his own way. He has brilliant ideas. And while he was in medical college. Yeah, now I can't hear Apurva Pouranik. Any other comment, question?
Hello, good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah. Good morning, sir, and good morning to Pouranik, sir. He was my teacher in Indore. So it's nice to see him here. Sir, my question is about developing a guideline. Suppose at present in this third surge of COVID, we are having a very fast peak. We see a very fast peak of COVID surge, and we don't have any protocol regarding RT-PCR for elective surgeries. Anesthesiologists and other, they advise for RT-PCR for elective surgery. But I search that there is no guideline or protocol all over the world regarding this. Yesterday also, MOHSW, and where I raised this question, so Dr. Randeep Guleria, sir, Dr. Randeep Guleria, sir, said that the region with the incidence of the disease, and it depends on the incidence of the disease that how we develop a guideline. So if we want to develop a guideline in our institution, then how we should proceed in such a fast progressing disease, which may have a very fast incidence and which regress also very fast. So we have a very narrow time gap in which we have to develop our protocols, and then we have to implement it. Because if we take time, then the disease will itself, it will be over. So is there any way to develop such guidelines or protocols in emergency way or in a fast manner so that we can implement it in our institution or elsewhere? Thank you, sir.
Right. So this is a very unprecedented situation. An initial guideline will be necessarily based on expert opinion. It will not be based on evidence. But while we develop the guideline, we also should start collecting evidence so that with time we can revise that guideline. To begin with, you have to develop a guideline within the institution. You can develop by having a group of experts sitting down, and based on expert opinion, which is the not a very high level evidence, but still based on expert opinion, you can start developing it. You can keep revising it as evidence keeps on emerging. So if you remember, our initial guideline at national level recommended hydroxychloroquine. It was based on some data which was from the lab, and many people agreed and used it. Many people did not agree and did not use it. But more and more data came, and today we know for sure that it has no role. So guideline has changed completely 180 degree, and that is bound to happen when you have a situation where you are forced to make guideline based on, let's say, limited data or no data. But as data comes, it will change, and you should be open about that. So if you are really very let's say hard pressed, a guideline based on expert opinion can be developed in a day. But that doesn't mean you should not carry out research or collect evidence. It should be done simultaneously, and so that with time you can revise it. And that revision may come in 1 month, 2 months, 3 months. In COVID time, WHO developed a group of people who were developing rapid clinical guidelines, so-called rapid, because within a month or 3 months, month to 3 months, they would develop a guideline, for example, for remdesivir, for tocilizumab, for and so on. So rapid may be as rapid as 1 day, or maybe as rapid as 3 months, but we are in a very unprecedented situation where we have to tailor our need and develop guideline based on limited or no data in the beginning, only expert opinion, and then revise it with time. I hope it helps.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
So just to let you know that next time we will take on some research methodology topic, and as we were earlier doing, most of the people who are working in a hospital, they can certainly do case control studies and cohort studies, not randomized trial very often, though you can do randomized trial. So next time I will take up case control study, how to determine sample size, and also cohort study, how to determine sample size, which can be done just by using a calculator, or maybe even without calculator if your math is okay. So that at least people know what studies we can do. And in the hospital, you have patients also, you have controls also. Hospital-based case control study or cohort study is eminently feasible. All departments, all units can do it, and I'm going to discuss about that in the next Saturday lecture. If there are no more questions, then thank you very much. Any other question? So thank you very much. We will meet again next Saturday at 9 o'clock.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Apoorva Puranik, for joining, and others who have joined from outside RIMS. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.